Give yourself back scratches.
Okay, hold on. Okay, I'm trying to picture myself. Oh, whoa!
So how did I get here? Scratching my own back with a robot controlled by my mind and a magic armband? Well, I got up early the day before and left LA to head back out on our journey. We're exploring who we will be, what powers human bodies will have by the year 2050. It brought me to a soggy New York.
It's pouring down rain.
We're here to try out an armband that lets me control things with my mind in digital and physical worlds. So what does that feel like, and where could this take us?
We'll find out in this episode of Future You with me, Elise Hugh.
There are already a handful of neurotech startups working on tools to meld mind and machine, known as brain-machine interfaces. Most of the devices are either implantable or worn on the head. CTRL-Labs is a little different.
CTRL-Labs.
Their brain-machine interface attaches to your arm.
We are trying out what is essentially the force. You know, the force that binds all things.
Okay, kind of like the force. The company has created an armband interface that lets you control digital objects, not with motion, but with your intention.
This is Jesslyn. She's one of the brains behind this technology. What do you call this device?
Control kit armband. It's basically gonna be able to read your neuron fires and you'll be able to play with our demos.
But my neuron fires are from up here, right?
Your neuron fires come from your brain. They go through your spine, through your nervous system. And well, if you think about it, when you move your fingers, those are all like instructions that are coming from your brain through your arm, right?
So that's why in this episode, I'm not wearing a cap. First time.
Here's how the armband works. It is not the same as a typical video game controller. It's not gesture-based at all. There are no cameras tracking my movement. This armband is a brain-machine interface that uses electromyography, or EMG, technology. The inside of my armband is lined with electrodes that touch my skin. And like Jesslyn said, the electrodes measure tiny electrical pulses of my nerve cells, or neurons. That means the band reads the motor neuron signals in my arm before my muscles react. That's how I can move digital objects, or even robots, before my body has moved, or even if I don't move at all. The device is reading neural signals, not muscle movement.
What we have here is a representation of your hands.
This is a loop directly from my brain to the computer, generating my hand on screen.
Oh, whoa. I'm here, but I'm also there.
I'm making some small movements with my hand, but they aren't necessary. Once I get better at this, you wouldn't be able to see my hands move at all. My mind would do the moving.
What does this feel like? I would say it feels really natural. Like, I am not having to think really hard. I'm simply moving, so it really does feel just like an extension of me.
Okay, so come and go.
Since the digital world I'm controlling is programmed, I have to learn the laws of the universe in order to control it.
Oh my goodness! Oh, Elise tried. Oh, Elise dropped it. The force is not yet with me.
Go, there you go. You're pushing it so far away. You're pushing it far away.
Oh, there it goes.
You're controlling that.
Now that we've tried out the force.
Oh my goodness.
There is no try.
Okay, now that we've begun to use the force.
You can just destroy whole worlds and then rebuild them.
We can take it further and actually control objects in the physical world, like this six-legged guy or gal.
Come to me, baby.
Oh. Now I don't feel so distanced anymore.
This is our little hexapod.
Doesn't need to have the googly eyes, but it kind of personalizes it a bit.
Oh, the googly eyes are so important.
It takes a little bit to get used to, but I'm amazed at how little it takes to like navigate and negotiate this object, right? Because we are not connected in any way except for digitally, right? And then these are just intentions and the force and strength of my arm. Which really means there's so many potentialities for the future.
In the year 2015.
I am here with Thomas Reardon. He goes by Reardon. He is a co-founder of CTRL-Labs, which is the maker of a lot of this future-facing technology. we're gonna put him through our super scenarios. So, based on the technology that you're making, what is a super human scenario that you can see this delivering for us by 2050?
It's as straightforward as the Force from Star Wars, this ability to have a kind of digital telekinesis, but that you can then bring into the real world. So yes, an extension of you where interacting with a computer and a machine no longer feels like something you're doing mechanically, but instead is just a fluid extension of your thoughts and subtle movements.
You were talking about the Force. Could I summon an object?
In a virtual world, sure. In the real world, no. The real world is regulated by physics, and physics works.
Darn.
But the question is, could you also have a little robotic buddy that's going down the street with you that can go and fetch that object for you?
What would be a super villain use of something like this?
There's always the danger inherent in it that they're going to be exploited to increase what I'll call human lethality. It could just be anybody looking for scale that goes beyond their ability to use their own body to exert lethal force in the world.
Let's get to super thorny. So when you think about where things get really ethically complicated or complex, what do you think about?
There are some substantial questions around privacy. The signals you generate neurologically are the most unique identifier of you ever. You are distinct not just from your clones, but every other human being who's ever lived. Give us 30 seconds of recordings from a person and we can identify that person for the rest of their lives. And we have to make sure that people who might have the opportunity to exploit it to track you don't have an easy way to go do that.
What is the super likely scenario for this technology by 2050?
I think you'll no longer see people staring down at that dumb brick as they're walking down the street or fighting with it to text message. You know, all these things that we think of as the Internet of Things that all have their perverse little interfaces like the Nest thermostat on the wall. There's
no
reason for me to go up and touch it and move it. I ought to be able to just look at it and change the temperature. The neural interfaces that we're working on get rid of the whole concept of movement and allow you to use that same neural flow to now control that Internet of Things, that sea of small little digital devices, but also, like I said, to summon an autonomous vehicle to the curb next to me.
Unconstrained by our physical bodies, what could our brains accomplish? Follow the future with us.
If you have any comments for me, you can write futureyou@npr.org or message me @EliseWho. You can subscribe to future episodes of Future You on YouTube or go to npr.org/futureyou.
Oh, you want to do your pinky pinch?
Oh, pinky.
Yeah.
Sorry. Dun, 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 dun. And this concludes our episode.